الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد, we praise Allah سبحانه وتعالى, and we ask Allah to exalt the mention and grant peace to the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. I see many are hasty to leave. Maybe you guys are hungry. Maybe you have a TV show to watch. I hope it's the first, at least. If you don't have anything important, I do recommend that we stick around just for a few minutes, inshallah. Perhaps we hear something that is beneficial for us, just in case, yani. Quickly, we want to highlight one ayah of the Quran and then link this to the current affairs. The ayah, or the ayat, is where Allah Azza wa Jal again described or categorized the human beings. And we said that last night. But in this case, Allah says, مَنْ كَانَ يُرِيدُ الْعَجِلَةَ عَجَّلْنَا لَهُ فِيهَا مَا نَشَاءُ لِمَنْ نُرِيدُ ثُمَّ جَعَلْنَا لَهُ جَهَنَّمَ يَصْلَاهَا مَذْمُومًا مَدْحُورًا. Whosoever seeks the quick life, the rapid life, this worldly life, which will go by quite fast. That's why it's called the ajila, something that is express, like express delivery, express mail. This worldly life is express. It doesn't take a long time to end. Allah said, عَجَّلْنَا لَهُ فِيهَا مَا نَشَاءُ. Whoever wants it, sure. We will give whatever we want to whomever we want. Allah will give that person as much as Allah wants, not as much as the person wants. It could be more than the person wants. This is in the dunya. So the person will be happy, maybe one will get excited. But then Allah said, however, we will prepare for that same person Jahannam, wherein he will enter humiliated and disgraced. So if we make a choice of choosing this worldly life, sure, you want money, take money. You want status, take the status. You want the entertainment habit, Allah will give. Later on the ayat, Allah said, كُلًّا نُمِدُّ هَؤُلَاءِ وَهَؤُلَاءِ مِنْ عَطَاءِ رَبِّكَ. Before we speak about the other types of people, Allah gives both from His bounty. And no one can stop the bounty of Allah. So that is the first type of people, which obviously we don't want. Because we may enjoy these 40, 50, 60 years, and then, خلاص, the entertainment will end. Once the person dies, there will be no more fun, no more. The money is not going to go with any one of us. No one will take his money with him. No one will take his clothing with him. No one will take his car with him. All this will be left behind. Left behind to people who don't care. They will remember you maximum, your closest family members, a month. Maybe 2 months if you are so dear to them. And then you become a memory. If they see your picture somewhere, they say, oh, rahimahullah. And then khalas, then the only thing left is us in the grave and the deeds. The other types of people is relevant to now. وَمَنْ أَرَادَ الْآخِرَةَ وَسَعَى لَهَا سَعْيَهَا وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ. Whosoever seeks the life to come, and then we have interesting choice of words. وَسَعَى لَهَا سَعْيَهَا. Now, sa'i, where have we heard that? In Hajj and Umrah. After you do the tawaf, you do sa'i. And sa'i, is it something that is extremely easy or does it take some effort? It takes effort. You're walking, you know, back and forth 7 times between the green lights. You are also running, right? Full speed for the men, obviously. The woman shouldn't run for reasons that are obvious to everyone. So sa'i is a term that indicates an effort, extra effort being exerted. Not merely amal. No, there's sa'i. وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ. And that person has to be a believer. Then it is those whose deeds will be appreciated. So now, does that mean that if you want to be the second, you have absolutely no part of the first? No, this is the misconception. This does not mean that you should, if you can afford a nice car, you buy a bicycle. And if you can live in a decent home, you live in a one-bedroom apartment. And if you have money, you don't use it. And you go live on a mountain somewhere in a tent and say, I'm waiting for Yawm al-Qiyamah. Why? Because أنا أريد الآخرة. This is a misapplication of the deen. Evidence, the Sahaba didn't do that. The Sahaba didn't do that. Those who came after them didn't do that. So the whole idea has to do with where the effort is being exerted. It may be that Allah facilitates for someone to acquire wealth. It's just the way, because each one has his risk, you know, written for him. The scholars say the whole thing has to do with where the sustenance is. Is it in your heart or in your hand? If it is in your hand, meaning you're well off now, tomorrow you're broke, you don't care. You won't leave the deen. You won't become, ungrateful to Allah. You won't turn on your heels. No fi mushkila. You take life as it comes to you. The one who's the worldly life, the dunya as in his heart, he can't handle it. If he went from richness to poverty, he would commit suicide. And this has happened. Many of the wealthy people who became broke, or not even broke, who just lost some wealth, they committed suicide. They got on drugs because they couldn't deal with that impact. For the believer, to you, it's all the same. If there's wealth, alhamdulillah. If there's no wealth, alhamdulillah. But it's in your hand, not in your heart. In this case, no harm on the person to enjoy what Allah has given him. In fact, according to a hadith, Allah loves to see the impact of His blessings upon you in your life. If Allah gives you wealth, He likes to see that you have used it in a manner that is pleasing to Him. In the halal, not going to the extreme of haram. So one shouldn't be miserly in this regard. So now the sa'i, that exertion or exerting oneself, applies to the last 10 nights of Ramadan. And today in the khutbah, which I don't think anyone from this masjid attended, whoever's playing with this bottle, like me, stop. Maybe this young man over here. Yes, thank you so much. I get easily distracted. In khutbah al-Jum'ah, I was in English actually at the Mushrifa Da'wah Center. We discussed the opinion of Abu Sa'id al-Khudri and some of the Sahaba, which was picked up by Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah and with scholars until today. That Laylatul Qadr can actually be in any of the last 10 nights and not only the odd nights. It could be in any of the last 10 nights and not only the odd nights. Yes, the odd nights is more probable. The 27th is even more probable among the odd nights. But in reality, it could be any one of the last 10 nights. The evidence for that are a hadith from the Prophet. Some of them where they clearly mention that it could be on the 23rd or the 25th and so on and so forth. And others where the Prophet said, لِسَبْعَةٍ بَاقِيَةٍ لِخَمْسَةٍ بَاقِيَةٍ. What does that mean? Meaning when they seek Laylatul Qadr, when there are 7 nights remaining, or when there are 5 nights remaining. Fine. Let's do some calculation. I'm not a mathematician, but this is simple inshallah. Ramadan can be either 29, 30 or 31 days, correct? Trick question. It can never be 31 days, right? It's either 29 or 30. We don't have 31 in the Gregorian calendar. But if Ramadan is 29 days, then it doesn't matter whether you count forward or backward in the last odd night, it will still be the odd nights. I'm sorry. If you count, it will be the odd nights. But if it were 30 and the Prophet ﷺ said, seek it when there are 7 nights remaining from Ramadan, what day would that be? The 24th. Because count, 24th, 25th, 26th, 27th, 28th, 29th, 30th. If Ramadan is 30 days, then when there are 7 nights remaining, that would be the night of the 24th. The 24th is an odd or even night. It's an even night because the odd are 21, 23, 25, 27, 29. And then you have 22, 24, 26, 28. So because of this position, which was adopted by some of the Sahaba, not everybody, and others, many of the ulama, not all of them, are of the opinion that you should actually exert yourself in all of these 10 nights. Because it could fall on any one of them, with the probability towards the odd nights and the 27th particularly being higher. But that does not exclude. What I'm trying to say is, we shouldn't say, okay, on the even nights, khalas, I sleep and I eat and I do absolutely nothing, and on the odd nights, I'm going to exert myself to the maximum. No, balance. Put an effort every night, and specifically on the nights which are odd, and specifically on the 27th. That is the message we're trying to communicate. Which means, if we have some shopping to do, we should have done it already, right? I hope we have. If we have not, get it out of the way. Already get it out of the way, so the closer you get to the end of Ramadan, specifically towards the 27th, the more freedom you want to have. You don't want to be busy still shopping for clothes and stuff like that. It will just be too much to handle. So the wise person will finish all of the purchases now so that they will have more time. If you can do it during the day while fasting, superb. Specifically the supermarket. Instead of going at night when it's crowded and there are, you know, hundreds of people and long queues and you waste 3 hours to get 10 items, if you go before iftar, the supermarket is technically empty. Right? And you get it done. Either way, if you're forced to go during the night, there's no harm in remembering Allah often and making dua. What I'm saying is, if one of us is in a situation where he's forced to still do some dunya related things on the last 10 nights of Ramadan, then be intelligent while driving the car, engage in some sort of ibadah. You don't have to raise your hands to make dua. It is a sunnah to raise the hands when making dua. It is definitely, but it is not a condition for the acceptance of dua. Meaning you can have your hand on the steering wheel and make dua. You can be saying as you drive, Allahumma naka afoon tuhibbul aqwa fa'afu anni. Or the other wording of the hadith, which is also authentic, Allahumma naka afoon kareemun tuhibbul aqwa fa'afu anni. There's one other narration with the word kareem, describing Allah Azza wa Jal. You can actually use both. You can either say Allahumma innaka afoon tuhibbul afwa fa'fu anni, or Allahumma innaka afoon kareemun tuhibbul afwa fa'fu anni. Both are authentic. You can do this while driving. You can do this while lying down on your bed. You can do it when whatever, as long as you're mindful of what you're saying. So if we're forced to do something, let us also be mindful of these ibadah. Listen to Quran, read whatever is keeps us in that zone of ibadah. So that's what I wanted to share with myself and you. Jazakumullahu khairan for sticking around after some of you are about to leave. Hada wallahu a'lam wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad. Oh, class announcement. This Monday, inshallah, sorry, I forgot. It's supposed to begin with this. There's a lecture that will be held at the International Medical Center. I don't know how many know this hospital. It's a big hospital in Hayy Ruwais, on Shara Hayy. Jazakumullahu khairan. So the lecture, inshallah, will be at 11 o'clock. It can be attended by both males, females, and children who are not too noisy. You saw one guy was playing with the bottle and I lost concentration. So if you bring a little baby who's going to cry the whole time, the lecture will be ruined. So either children that can be controlled, or the children should find a babysitter or something. But anyways, everyone is welcome to join. There are no fees, no money, no one will ask you who you are, write down your name, nothing. You come, listen, finish, and leave. The lecture will be at 11 p.m. in the main auditorium. In the International Medical Center, the speaker is a surprise. I don't know if that works. Anyways, no one from outside. Assalamu alaikum.